Good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. I hope everyone has had a good summer recess. We have received apologies this morning from Michelle Thompson. But before we start, I want to thank those who participated so actively in a pre-budget scrutiny event last week in Largs and indeed the following day that we had in West Kilbride. I know members had lively and interesting discussions with local people, organisations and businesses about their priorities for the Scottish Budget, which will help us with a pre-budget scrutiny. We publish a summary note of discussions on our website in due course. I also wish to record our thanks to Douglas Lumsden for all his hard work in supporting the committee's scrutiny, and I'm pleased to welcome Jamie Halcrow-Johnson as a new member of the committee. We're also joined today by Gordon MacDonald, who's attending the meeting as substitute member in Michelle's absence. I'd invite first Jamie and then Gordon to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you very much, convener. My only interest I think might be of relevance as I'm a partner in a farming business and I have a number of shares in Tetragen and in Standard Life.
Thank you. Gordon?
Thanks, convener. I've got no relevant interest to declare.
Okay, thank you very much. The next item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Scottish Fiscal Commission on their forecast evaluation report and paper on productivity and fiscal sustainability, both published on the 29th of August. I'd like to welcome to the meeting Professor Graham Roy, Chair, Professor Francis Breeden, Commissioner, and Claire Murdoch, Head of Fiscal Sustainability and Public Funding at the Scottish Fiscal Commission. I intend to allow up to 75 minutes for this session. And before we open up to questions from the committee, I'd like to invite Professor Roy to make a short opening statement. Graham.
Good morning, and thank you for inviting us to give evidence on our latest forecast evaluation report and our paper on productivity and fiscal sustainability. Forecast evaluation is an important part of how we work as an organisation, and our forecasts are an essential part of the budget. And by evaluating these forecasts, we aim to improve transparency and confidence in that process. So I'd like to start by talking about income tax, for which we now have outturn data for 2021-2022. Looking at our budget setting forecast for that year made in January 2021, we see a significant underestimate of the outturn data by around 12% or £1.5 billion. Now, importantly for the Scottish Budget, there was a similar scale and direction of error in the BGA based on forecasts by the Office for Budget Responsibility. What caused this underestimate? Well, it's partly a good news story. The early 2021 lockdown was not as severe or as long as many feared, and the economy and labour market recovered more rapidly than many people had anticipated. Because of the rapid global recovery in 2021, inflation also started to rise, pushing up nominal incomes. Another factor we've seen is strong growth in tax revenues in the top end of the income distribution in Scotland, particularly among those paying tax via self-assessment. Now, as financial year 2021-2022 progressed, we published updated estimates of Scottish income tax revenues in that year. For that, rather than rely upon revising our economy forecasts, we used data called real-time information, or RTI, on PAYE collections from HMRC to incrementally update our forecasts. By December 2022, our estimates for that year were based upon complete RTI tax data. Now, this RTI data helped to inform our upward revision of estimates of Scottish income tax as the year progressed and as the economy opened back up. However, you'll recall that when we met in June, we were discussing a potential reconciliation of £712 million based upon a comparison of these latest estimates and those of the OBR. We now have a near final reconciliation figure for 2021-2022 of £390 million based on outturn data. So the difference between these two elements is explained by two factors. First, the outturn data was stronger than suggested by the RTI data. And secondly, there were higher than expected Scottish income tax revenues at the top end of the income distribution, particularly through self-assessment. Now, we continue to see RTI as a helpful tool for monitoring income tax revenues in the year, and it's something we continue to look at to see what options are to improve accuracy and to communicate the range of uncertainties we face. I now turn briefly to some of our other forecasts. Land and building transaction tax revenue is £848 million, was £99 million higher than forecast for 2022-2023, an error of 13%. Residential properties saw faster pricing growth and there were more high-value transactions than forecast. Spending on devolved social security in 2022-2023 was £4.2 billion, £127 million or 3% higher than forecast. This was a result of higher spending on disability payments and post-budget policy announcements by the Scottish Government. We might come on to this in discussion, but a higher part of that spending on disability payments appears to be UK-wide trends. The Scottish and UK governments recently published a joint communique following the fiscal framework review. Now, both governments support this committee's recommendation. We publish frequent full and supplementary fiscal sustainability reports, and I'm pleased to say that we'll now be developing that work over the coming months. Finally, last week we published a paper exploring how changes to productivity growth would affect projections made in our fiscal sustainability report. And we conclude that even though higher productivity growth leads to faster economic growth, higher wage growth, and likely better public services for people of Scotland, on its own it doesn't necessarily translate into a more sustainable fiscal position. Improvements in fiscal sustainability are likely to require changes not just in the economy, but in public spending and tax policy too.
Thank you very much for that, Professor Roy. And obviously I'll kick off the questions and then we'll open up to members on the committee. And I'm going to start with the issue that you just touched on. And I won't quote the full paragraph of what you said, but basically what you've said here is that, well, higher productivity growth has a clearly positive effect on the economy. The net effects on the public finances are complicated. And to improve fiscal sustainability will require changes in public spending or tax policy. Now, Professor Spowidge actually talked about this last week at a way day, but I'd be quite interested if you could explain the reasoning for this, you know, the fact that increased productivity might not actually reduce sustainability gap, because I think it's quite crucial to our deliberations as we move forward, and I think it's important to get it on the record. So that's the first thing, explain the reasoning. And the second, the kind of changes that would be required to actually close that gap, even in a situation where we have increasing productivity.
Okay, great. I'll kick off and then my colleagues will probably want to come in as well. So the first important point I think to make is that faster productivity growth improves the economy of Scotland overall and therefore leads to potential better public services. But when we think about it from a fiscal context, from a public finance context, there are certain different factors that are going on here. So faster productivity growth leads to higher wages, which therefore leads to higher revenues. And that is a positive effect on the public finances. But on the other hand, faster productivity growth leads to a higher and a faster growing and bigger economy. Now, what you then assume about what happens to public services in that context is really crucial. So the assumption that we make, which is the same as the OBR, is that essentially that public services maintain the same share of the economy as the economy continues to grow. So as the economy gets bigger, the relative share of public services increases in line with that. And there's good reasons for that. If you think about wages, for example, if wages in the economy are growing at 3%, 4%, 5%, you would expect public service wages to be growing at the same rate to keep pace without having a gap between the two. So what happens is that you've got two effects going on here. You've got faster revenue growth and you've got faster spending growth as well. Now, in a devolved context, in a Scottish context, essentially, you have the proportion of revenues, which are from income tax and non-domestic rates and council tax, which are a smaller proportion than the overall spending envelope. So you've got two elements growing here. You've got one element, which is the larger public spending element, growing by the faster growth in productivity, and you get revenues growing at the same rate, but one is smaller than the other. And that's why the gap opens up. The productivity doesn't necessarily lead to an improvement in the fiscal position. What's crucial then, though, is what do you do about the benefits of faster productivity? So do you choose to increase spending by the same amount, or do you choose to increase it by less? But that's ultimately a policy choice, which comes back to our conclusion, which is that you would need to make a conscious decision to change the relative share of public spending in the economy, or make a decision on taxation, or make a decision on how much growth you're translating through to the public finances over time.
I mean, you're absolutely right. It is, of course, a policy choice. I'm not asking you to make those policy choices. I mean, because of course you would demur if I did. But it is quite interesting, actually, is it not, that that you have touched on the situation of the current devolution arrangements, and you have said that we either would have to change public spending or tax policy. So what would we have to change to bring the finances into long-term sustainability?
So this comes back to what I guess what we said in our fiscal sustainability report, in that ultimately fiscal sustainability is, you know, in this context that we've looked at so far, is saying that essentially the amount of spending that you have is running ahead of the funding that, that will likely be available, driven by the pressures on demographics and rising costs in key services. So ultimately, it's going to be a combination of everything. So it's going to be a combination of improvements in the economy leading to better quality public services, which might mean that you can make some savings in public services over time. Secondly, it's about potentially choices about what to prioritise in some areas over the other. And that doesn't necessarily mean, you know, cutting expenditures or trying to reduce service, but it could mean, for example, as we've spoken about before, shift to prevention to try and reduce the long-term spend per head on healthcare over someone's lifetime. Or ultimately, it's going to have a conversation about what do you do around taxation. So where might you potentially look to increase the amount you're raising in the economy in order to spend on public services? One point I would say that, again, is really important in all of this is that, as we said before, is that the challenges that we're talking about here aren't unique to Scotland. And some of the things that this comes through is how this interacts with the fiscal framework and the decisions at the UK level. So if the UK had faster productivity, then we would get more money coming through the block grant. So if Scotland was to have faster productivity and the UK was to have faster productivity, we would get more funding as a coming through as a result of that. But at the same time, there'd be pressures at a UK level in order to keep public spending rising in the same share as the economy. So there's lots of different moving parts. And ultimately, I think what we conclude is that it can't just be seen as being purely an economy solution or purely a public spending solution or purely a tax solution. It's got to be a combination of all three elements.
Okay, that's fine. I mean, obviously, if the economy improves, one would expect that there'd be fewer people dependent on public services, and you know, and if health, people's health improves, that would also have the same impact.
Exactly, and just to say, this is purely what we're talking about here is purely from a public finance a perspective, a numerical basis. Clearly, if we have faster productivity, and you're investing that in public services will be better. So that will lead to higher quality public services and improved outcomes. What we're saying is that if you do that, that means that spending will increase. So therefore, it doesn't automatically mean that you're going to reduce the fiscal sustainability. So I don't want to create the impression that faster productivity is not a good thing for public services. It is. But unless you take a conscious decision not to pass the benefits of that on to public services, then you're not going to close the fiscal sustainability gap.
Okay, I think that's pretty clear, and colleagues can ask further questions on that if they so wish. Just moving on into more detail in terms of the forecast evaluation report. On page 19, you said that the top rate taxpayers have increased in number from 14,700 to 18,000. Yet on page 46, you say, and I quote, tax revenues from top rate taxpayers have recently fallen in the last 2 years. So, why is that? If there's a significant increase in them, why the revenues have actually fallen, given the fact that we're in an inflationary position?
Clay, if you want to come back in the page 46 with it, to find the point. So one general point I'd like just make first of all is one of the things that we that surprised on the upside with the forecast is the growth in top rate taxpayers in Scotland. So at the really high end of the tax distribution, that was higher than was essentially being reported through the PYE, what we thought we would get. Now that offsets a fall that we've seen in previous years, so the growth rate in that has been less over the preceding years. What we have is just for the 1 year, for 21-22, is that there's an increase back. So I think we've spoken in the past about was it maybe like 13,000, 14,000 higher rate taxpayers in Scotland, and now it's up to 18,000. And I think there's a chart on page 47 where you see in the two preceding years the top rate of tax, people actually falling, and then the increase this year. So you've got an increase this year, but it comes in the back of relatively weaker growth in the preceding couple of years.
Right, okay, so the revenue from that group is not decreasing then? Because the reason I was asking the question is it just seemed to be a contradiction between what was being said on page in 1946, where one talks about, you know.
So on page 46, we're saying that the tax revenues paid by the top band have fallen in 2 years, not in the last year.
Right.
So okay. The tax revenues paid by the top band fell from the previous year in 1920 and 2021, but then the year that we're now evaluating, which is 21-22, the revenues paid by the top band increased significantly.
I mean, I touch on this because there's 0.7% of taxpayers, but about one sixth of income tax comes from them. And I think throughout the document, you kind of made a point of talking about the volatility, actually, of that specific group. So I think there's an issue there that we have to keep an eye on. I mean, another point from your report, I think, which again comes through quite strongly on a number of occasions, is self-assessment. Mm. I mean, if we look at the graph on page 21, it's quite astonishing when we look at the jump in the outturn figures for self-assessment, yeah. You know, which far exceed any others. I'm just wondering if, for the record, you can explain that a wee bit.
Yeah, so, and before getting on to that, if I could come back to the general point you made, first of all, about the importance of the higher rate and the top rate taxpayers. So the nature of the income tax system, they're absolutely crucial for the revenues that are raised because of the progressivity of the tax system. So small changes in the top rate, the number of people in that top rate, or small changes in their earnings, have significant impacts on tax revenues. So that's why that forecast in there, we do our best to estimate the number of taxpayers and the changes in there, but very small percentage variations potentially lead to significant swings in income tax. To give you, there's a figure there, I think on page 46, we talk about the top rate taxpayers, so 18,000 top rate of taxpayers, equivalent to about £2.5 billion in there. So you change these small numbers of percentage and you can get large swings there, which gets on to the point about self-assessment, because most top rate taxpayers, well, all top rate taxpayers, people earning above £100,000 and people with complex tax affairs pay through the self-assessment system. So even at a UK level, it's the most volatile element of the tax system. It's the bit that's subject to the greatest change because it reflects a whole manner of different factors, between adjustments for previous years, sources of incomes, classifications and the like. So it's the hardest bit to forecast at a UK level, but a Scottish level is even harder because of the data that we have on that. So the first bit is that we don't get any self-assessment data until the January after the end of the tax year. So we can look at things like PAYE and track that through the year, but you won't have any idea about self-assessment until the end of the January the following year. And what HMRC say is that many people pay self-assessment returns in the January, so you've really got to wait to the end to get to that. The second point is that the quality of the data and actually the information we have about Scottish self-assessment is really quite weak. It's probably the biggest gap that we have in the income tax system. And we don't have, for example, regional self-assessment data across the UK. Again, that reflects some of the complexities about tax individuals. PAYE is quite obvious because you've got your employer and you've got your employee, and it's quite a simple mechanical transaction. Self-assessment is much more difficult to pin down. So self-assessment has always been the bit that is the greatest unknown in our forecast. So when you have years, as you mentioned on page 21, where you have 20% growth in self-assessment, then that is just very difficult for us to forecast, and that's why the margin of error becomes that much greater overall.
Yes, I mean, you've said in the annex, you know, in paragraph 26, you've said the variation in tax revenue generated by the highest earners is likely to continue to be a source of significant uncertainty and forecast error with very limited data available on that group. But you've said in the future HMRC's MTD project may improve the situation. And then you go on to say, to continue to improve a forecast, we will focus on better understanding what determines changes in tax revenues of the highest earners. So, I mean, this goes back to actually page 3, where you talked about, you would mention points for improvement in the annex. I take it that's one of the areas, and what specifically are you going to be able to do, given the kind of paucity of data, to try and improve forecasting for this volatile
group? Yeah, so I wouldn't underestimate that it's difficult. So we're speaking to HMRC about what more information we can get around self-assessment, but also in the PAYE data and how that relates through. I would caution that the nature of self-assessment means it is quite difficult to get the data on a Scottish context. And even then, small variations in what we can get will lead to big swings in it. I think the third bit within all of that is, I think I'm really quite keen is that we can be as transparent as possible and be really quite clear about the range of uncertainty and the range of variability that could exist with these forecasts. We've now got some data points about just showing how volatile self-assessment could be. And we've now got a number of years of that data. So we can then factor that into our forecast and say, look, the potential for variability in here is quite good. So to give an example of the potential variability. So when we were looking at the PYE real-time information, so that's administrative data being tracked by HMRC to show PYE income in Scotland, that was picking up around about 12% growth in incomes. Self-assessment was 20% growth. So it's very difficult for us to think, well, could it be 20% or could it be 2% next year? And that's the volatility that we need to get a better handle on, not just in terms of doing our best to estimate it, but doing our best to communicate that this is quite volatile and that has implications for how the government plan its budget. And the potential scale of reconciliations that come out from the forecast being different from outturn.
Yeah, I think it's worth adding that this has happened. This big surge in self-assessment has happened, and even in retrospect, we don't really understand why it's happened. And so this is going to be a very challenge. I mean, we can sort of at the edges improve our forecast in this area, but I think this is going to be an area that will always, as Graham says, we really just have to manage the volatility. That this is a very difficult area of tax to get a handle on, and indeed the OBR with a longer history of doing it with more data, they find it extremely challenging too. So I think we have to live with this double problem with self-assessment, which is it's very volatile and it's pretty much the last bit of data we get. So it's always going to have the potential to surprise us right at the end of the process.
Okay, thank you. Just one more question from me and then we'll open up to colleagues around the table. And it's with regard to your Annex B, paragraph 8 and 9, and you say that Scotland's lagging earnings growth since 2016-17 has been exacerbated by much stronger earnings growth in the financial services sector in London and the South East. You go on to talk about Scottish employment being linked to the North Sea has fallen, lowering the average participation rate in Scotland. These jobs were generally high-paying, which has likely contributed to the divergence in average earnings between Scotland and the UK. What kind of pace are we talking about? I mean, what is the kind of decline in overall earnings that's coming from that sector relative to the rest of Scotland? Because obviously that's quite fundamental. It's also quite fundamental for the green transition process that we're trying to undergo at this time.
So we can get some updated numbers. We had a box maybe about, I think it was in the last December's forecast, it was maybe in May or the December before that, where we had a bit of analysis about trends in employment and income in the North East, and you do see that divergence. So we can send an update on that to the committee. What that does show is far less employment growth than in the rest of the country and far slower earnings growth than in the rest of the country. And again, this comes back to the point about why this is important for the forecasts is because of the progressive nature of income tax. People with high earnings, and that tends to be in oil and gas for reasons around it's a difficult place to work, it's high profits, there's risks to it, then it leads to high incomes. If that doesn't grow or you lose jobs there, then that has a disproportionate impact on the tax revenues. And that's one of the factors that we see about opening up the gap between Scotland and the rest of the UK. So key is then, from a policy perspective, is think about how you transition those high-paying jobs that we know will disappear in the next few decades as oil and gas transitions into other high-paying jobs in other sectors, including in renewables, but in broader sectors within the economy in order to offset those differences in earnings, because the fiscal framework, what matters is that relative growth in earnings.
Okay, thank you. And I should say that despite the coming out of the pandemic and the Ukraine war and the cost of living crisis and inflation, I think to have a GDP forecast there of 0.2% is quite remarkable, really. I know there's been one or two areas within that where it's been quite high, but I still think it's a pretty an excellent job that the Scottish Fiscal Commission has done. So I'm now going to open up to colleagues, and the first to ask questions will be Ross, to follow by Liz.
Thanks, Convener. Just as a point of clarification, in the first instance on the self-assessment data for Scotland, you mentioned that there's not enough data. Is that unique to the Scottish self-assessment data, or is that a UK-wide issue and it matters more to us because of scale and also how our public finances work?
There are a couple of things. So self-assessment is always difficult to forecast, even at a UK level. So it's a bit that the OBR would tell you that it's one of the most difficult elements for them to forecast. It doesn't matter as much to them because it's one element of income tax amongst a whole multitude of other taxes, whereas for the Scottish fiscal framework, it's a key element of the one big tax that we have. So if they were having forecast errors of 15, 20% in self-assessment, it would just get washed up with everything else in it, whereas it matters here in the context for Scotland more. But then there's an extra element, which is that at a UK level, identifying the location of self-assessment taxpayers is just that much more difficult to pin it down than it is under the PUIE system, where you've got an employer and an employee residence, very simple. Self-assessment is just much more difficult to do, and we don't get it until late. So it's the combination of all these factors make it difficult to forecast on self-assessment. Do you want to add anything?
Just one more thing is just to add that we're forecasting based on when the tax is due, so when people earn that self-assessment income. At the UK level, they're slightly more worried about when the cash is coming in. So that difference also means they're getting sort of real-time information on how much self-assessment is being paid in that financial year, and that's ultimately what the UK government cares about in terms of managing their budget, managing their borrowing, whereas the way the Scottish government has to manage its budget, we're concerned a lot more about when the tax was liable, not when it was actually paid to HMRC.
Thanks. You mentioned that you've been speaking to the Treasury about this, and we can ask the Minister this when or any of the Ministers this when they come to give evidence, but are you aware if Scottish Government has engaged with Treasury on these points as well?
I wouldn't know that. I think from our perspective, we do it from a purely technical point of view, so we're dealing it with the analysts and officials to try and get their insights, because they've been doing this for much longer, so try and get their insights about what's the quality of the information, what's the quality of the data. And you see as well, I think our forecast from in May was surprising the downside, so the outturn data was higher, but so was the OBR. So the OBR forecast for Scottish income was the same thing. So this is something that we're all trying to wrestle with to get a better understanding about the drivers of the flows.
And I think let's say that the self-assessment data itself, I don't think it's going to get much going to change there. So I think the sort of data we're looking for is other indicators that will give us a clue as to what the self-assessment data will be, and that's the sort of thing where more data is coming, because the RTI is expanding in the range of stuff we're getting from it. And secondly, and I think we struggle across all our forecasts, and this is true in the forecast evaluation, we still have a very short history of data to work with. So when you're trying to do statistical analysis to find out what the issues are, five observations is simply not enough to give you a lot of that. And so I think just a passage of time will help improve the way we do this.
Thanks so much. And on a somewhat similar point about the challenges of the short period in which we're doing this, I'm going to ask the same question that I ask every year at this point around the work you do looking back at the behaviour change estimations related specifically to changes to income tax. So we started making significant variations from 2018 onwards. Given that we're now getting somewhat further away from that point, and recognising that it's very hard to disaggregate that from all the other changes that may result in a change in the revenue that's eventually raised, do you have any further observations about whether your estimations around behaviour change related to income tax rises have borne out or not?
So one thing that we are talking about and looking to do is we've now got more data points, is that can we actually start to look at some of the data that's been collected to try and see if we can see patterns of behaviours and change there. it still is quite early, and I know you'll probably be fed up with me answering that question of you all the time, but we will start to get information where we can see, you know, potentially changes in things like categories of within the PUE system, like earnings, residence, etc. But it will be very subtle, and that's the point. One of the things that we've talked about, behavioural change. A lot of the time, people think behavioural change is being quite the obvious behavioural change, that if you put up tax, then you leave, or if you cut tax, you come in. Actually, the behavioural change that we're talking about is really subtle. So it's about people changing their earnings, people changing how much hours they work at the margin, or changing their classification between non-savings and non-dividend income and dividend income. Is very marginal, so it means that we'll need longer data to wait and see what happens in all of that.
Thanks, Arch. That was all from me for now.
Okay, thank you. Liz, to be followed by John.
Thank you. Good morning. Professor Roy, can I just come back to an answer that you gave to the convener in the first instance about the this very important issue about the increase in public spending and also in tax revenues, and you set out the fact that, you know, increasing productivity is all very good, but then that there are some issues about the rate of change in the public spending commitment as well as the rate of change in tax, because that's what's going to be crucial. And can I just relate that to a comment that David Bell said, and I quote, "Nevertheless, given the potential consequences of widening fiscal gap on the ability to provide public services, it is important that as full an understanding of the causes of change in demand for public services and changes in tax revenues can be available to the Scottish Government." Can I ask you, how easy is it to get the necessary data to understand what is causing the changes in demand for public services? Because that's obviously critical to policy decision making. Mm-hmm.
So to be clear, what we do in our report is that we essentially take the existing demand for public services and the existing usage of public services and then push it forward with the changes in population. So we don't make a judgment in our report about changes in drivers of demand within all of within that. We just say this is essentially your entitlement, and this is how much we spend in healthcare at this moment in time, age of the population, what's the additional increases in public expenditure. So we don't make a judgment call about demand for that. But the point and the quote that you mentioned there from Professor Bell then, I think, starts to get to the heart of what do you then potentially do about this? Because you can continue to have the same amount of public expenditure, but you're shifting the balance within that. So you're changing the drivers of the demand in there. So examples would be around, we have a high amount of healthcare expenditure, and that we just push that forward. But a lot of that healthcare expenditure at the moment is on corrective surgeries or on addressing ill health. If you can then change that to be more about preventative and reducing these demands over time, then that will change how much money you would then put into the healthcare budget over the longer term. So that's the sort of area where I think then you can then make choices about how much you spend, but then it's how do you actually change what you choose to spend that money on. And that could either come through discretionary choices to shift balances of expenditure or by changing the demand that you're having on these services, which is the point that I think David Bell is making.
I'm just interested in this because, as you rightly said just now, this is all about getting to the heart of what makes policy making. And I fully understand the Scottish Fiscal Commission's role in this, that you're very much involved in the sort of statistical analysis of a quantitative basis, projecting demographic trends and how that population is changing. What actually matters to policymakers is whether there are trends within these demographic changes that are leading to changes in demand. And actually, that's the crucial thing for the Scottish Government. Is it possible from the work that you do over a period of years to isolate some trends of that change in demand, or is that something that you wouldn't do in the Fiscal Commission?
So it's something we've done it to an extent, in the sense that In individual portfolio components, we change the demand. So, for example, in our projections, we reduce expenditure on education as a share because we've got fewer young people, and we increase it on health because we've got more older people. So we've done that. I guess the question is, can we then perhaps go a level below that and say, you know, within the components that we are making an assumption that the average spend on health increases as we get older, can you potentially look at within that, are there different elements that you could use to see, well, actually, if you have higher proportions of degenerative diseases, or you can change it at the margin, then potentially that's an area which you could look at. And one of the areas that we've spoken about in the fiscal sustainability consultation that we did was one of the areas we could look at is health inequalities, for example, and what might be driving that leading to higher demands over time. And if you were to change that, what would the effects be? So drilling into that, those elements is one thing you could do.
I'm asking the question because obviously during the last session we had a number of witness sessions with people who are in the public sector, and we've been as a committee asking what can we do to progress public sector reform, and the answer to that actually depends on some of the stuff that you're saying just now, because it is the future demand for some of these public services that is absolutely critical for the Scottish Government to make sensible policy announcements as to where that demand is going to increase and where it's going to fall. And I'm just anxious to know if we think that we have the right data to be able to get to that set of information so that the Scottish Government and this committee is able to make sensible policy suggestions.
It's something we can definitely have a look at and see what we would do around our projections around individual components of that. The key point I think I would make is that what our analysis shows essentially is that if you're trying to make an adjustment on the spending side, you essentially need to reduce spending per head over the life cycle of someone demanding healthcare services. Because if you don't do that, then if we all just demand at the same level, then if you become older, that will increase expenditure. So how can you shift into things like prevention, et cetera, and the like, which gets into some challenges about how you prioritise all of that. I mean, so it's one area we could potentially look at around doing a deeper dive into something like healthcare and looking at the different components of within that health budget, about what might happen if you project forward in particular elements within there. Again, we'd want to be quite careful. We're not making choices about health policy, et cetera, but can you decompose the elements of health into some that are particularly tied to demographics or particularly tied to...
Absolutely understand the point you're making. It's not your job to suggest the policies. Yeah. It's just to be effective on policy making, you need the right data.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you go back to your sustainability report that you've projected over 50 years, you know, the increase in health spending, in social care spending, and social security spending, these are all big asks.
Yeah.
And it's helpful to understand just exactly what the demand is composed of and whether there are other areas of public sector spending where there might be a little bit more scope for efficiencies. That's a dilemma that faces this committee.
Yeah. And it's something we can, when we're thinking about doing our update, potentially write a bit more about what are the individual components within underneath these portfolios. In some areas like education, it's relatively simple. So it's high schools, universities, colleges, primary schools, nursery. So it's quite obvious to split it. Healthcare gets a wee bit more tricky because it doesn't naturally go into these sets of boxes. But we can look at within health, for example, are there different elements you could look at that have, is there data there that could help you get an idea about different pressures that might come through demographics and age over time, and write that up and share that?
My final question is just on that point about preventative expense. I find that incredibly difficult to measure because it's almost an unknown, but it matters in terms of the amount of money that you, as an opportunity cost, it matters, but it matters in terms of how much money can you actually save by preventative spending. I just wondered if you have any guidance as to what methodology we should be using to sort of look at preventative spending, because it's going to matter for policy.
Yeah, there's perhaps less you could do within the context of fiscal sustainability in our work in fiscal sustainability, because the aggregates we use are so high. So, for example, a key thing to reducing health demand over the next 10 to 15, 20 years could be housing, or it could be education, or it could be employability, because it would be much more difficult to pin that through. But that then gets on to the point, I think, about where the evidence base has to get better, which is knowing that if we invest in a particular area, what are the long-term outcomes that are coming over time? And we should do better at that. We should track more about the evaluation of programmes. So we've had expansions in childcare, we've had changes in employability policies, we've had changes in different elements of healthcare, education. The key question is, if these are preventative policies, if these are designed to long-term outcomes, what's the evidence that they have actually had the impact? And once you have that evidence, you can then update like our projections and things like that to see how you might tackle these over time, and that's the sort of thing we'll cover in our health inequalities work.
It's also the case that I guess a lot of this work on preventative measures and the costs and benefits of them, there are very good micro studies done, not by us but by others, to evaluate individual measures and what the impacts of those individual measures are. So I think that's a good source. We don't use that because we don't get into that level of detail, but that's certainly a very good source if you're thinking about particular areas.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. John, to be followed by Michael.
Thanks so much, Convener. Going back to some of the kind of predictions that were made and forecasts, both by yourselves and OBR, I mean, I accept that the Ukraine war was probably not predictable, although some experts in that field might say it was. But inflation, I mean, neither yourselves nor the OBR nor I think society at large saw the levels of inflation coming along that were. I mean, in retrospect, should we have been able to predict that inflation was coming?
I think the projection was always that inflation would increase post-pandemic, and there was the significant increase of expansionary monetary policy at the time was designed to stop a slowdown in the economy. So it was always designed to happen. It was always designed to increase inflation. I think the real surprise, or the bit that economists and we and everyone didn't fully anticipate, was that the immediately post-pandemic was the dislocated start-up that happened across the global economy. Essentially meant that supply chains were gummed up right across the global economy, and that led to a significant spike in manufacturing prices, particularly because of what was happening in China. So if you look at the forecast, the track record of the forecast, there was a forecast for an increase in inflation, but then it started to add on to that as the global supply chains became more obvious that they were going to be as a break. Then on top of that, you then had Ukraine and the spike in energy prices, and that led to the really significant increase we've seen. And there's still a debate about how quickly this is coming down, and one thing I would caution is that every time you see a monthly data on inflation, and Francis knows this much better than I do, I want to come in, but everyone jumps on whether it's below expectations or was it a faster fall, and we know it's coming down. The question is, how sticky will it be? And that gets into questions about wages, etc. So I think inflation was always going to increase, but I don't think anyone expected it to increase as much as it did.
Professor?
Yeah, no, I think as a sort of a forecaster of quite a long career in forecasting, the conditions we had prior to the Ukraine war, if that happened in my early part of my career, tight labour markets, in terms of trade shock, we would have been forecasting very high inflation. But actually, what we've seen since the era of low inflation is that inflation has been incredibly anchored by all sorts of shocks for so many years that we all got used to the idea that you could almost shock anything and inflation will stay anchored. And I think that was the mistake possibly that we all made. And maybe the old hands like me should have come in earlier. Not that I thought this was going to happen. It's just that this is what we were used to in the 70s and 80s, and we haven't been used to for a very long time.
Yeah, I mean, I remember 15% inflation, and we just kind of lived with that, and people have got not used to that. So, I mean, going forward, do we just have to accept that the same is likely to happen in future, that we might see a bit of inflation coming, but it is quite hard to predict how much?
Yes, I think the idea of that incredibly uncut inflation is now sort of gone now because it's been lost, and so we are going to be not back in the 70s and 80s, but we are in a period where we won't just be in a situation where the economy could be shocked in any direction and inflation stays at roughly 2%. We're in a world where we'll have to be used to a little bit more volatility, I think.
Okay. I mean, just to touch on some of the minor taxes, although I accept that the impact is much less, but the comment was made that house prices were unpredictable and I think had also risen more than had been anticipated. Is that just purely the inflation factor?
A combination of that. I think there's the higher prices and higher value transactions with it were the two drivers on the upside. We actually had fewer overall transactions than we were expecting, so we had fewer turnover of houses, but the houses that were being turned over were higher valued and increase in price. And again, that's quite volatile, so we've underestimated it in the past and overestimated it as well. So that, again, we're getting a better handle on the genuine volatility that exists at the moment.
And on landfill tax, I think the comments made that incineration capacity was limited and uncertain. So I don't know if that was machinery breaking down or what it was, but I assume that that meant that more had to be put into landfill that should have been incinerated.
Yeah. So we make assumptions about what can be incinerated, and so there was less forecast and there was more forecast at what would be incinerated and actually happened, and there's various, we talk about it in the report, various aspects about that in terms of capacity and new things coming on stream and faults in incineration, etc., that vary that.
Okay, and then the bigger one is social security. Now, I mean, I think we now understand that the Scottish Government is generally nicer than the UK Government and so is more generous handing out social security. So is that kind of built into the system now? Because it seems to have been that you've slightly underestimated how much was going to be paid out each year.
There's a couple of things going on. So we're forecasting 2022-2023 when adult disability payments were the really big ones only just coming on. So it's less about what the Scottish Government has been doing of the new system relative to what's gone before. Our error on Social Security is really essentially driven by two elements. One is a smaller element, which is around about a third of a change in policy by the government since we made our forecast, and that was the bringing forward of the Scottish Child Payment earlier than we had anticipated. The main change and the main reason for the forecast error is growth in adult disability payment, but we think that isn't due to the Scottish Government a change in policy or your interpretation of the two governments, and more to do with trends in disability payments across the UK. So you've probably heard there's lots of discussion going on at the moment about the increase in applications to disability benefits across the UK, rises in activity from people in ill health, perhaps as a hangover from COVID, perhaps as broader concerning trends around things like mental health. So across the UK, we're seeing an inflow of people onto disability payments that are much higher than happened pre-COVID. And that comes through our number in Scotland. So the error we've got is essentially mirroring the error that we see at the UK level. And that's probably more of the reason than a differentiation at this stage between Scotland and the rest of the UK.
Okay. So moving kind of back to income tax, just to maybe carry on some of the points that have been raised already. The point that the higher earners, now I get the point that self-assessment, if people presumably are self-employed, then they may not even know what their earnings are going to be for a year, let alone anyone else. But there would also be higher earners like the chief executive of a council or something like that, who presumably are in the self-assessment category, and they would be quite predictable. But are they just kind of swamped by the ones that are unpredictable?
Yes, and so some people who do self-assessment pay through PYE, so you can get returns on that. But then you've got potential other people who are much more volatile, more complex tax affairs. So it's not just self-assessment doesn't just cover high earners. It covers people with complex tax affairs, and that's the bit which is much more volatile as a result of that. There's also a bit where we talk about in the report about difference between the RTI PYE data that we can track, and then the outturn data on PYE, and you see again differences in that. So actually, this is about people maybe changing tax code at the end of the year, you know, being identified as a Scottish taxpayer relative to a UK taxpayer. And that just means that the data that is collected on PAYE through the year is actually different from the PAYE data, outturn data at the end of it. And it's just people with complex tax affairs, which means that these numbers move around a lot.
Yeah, I mean, that is a little bit disappointing, because I'd kind of got the impression previously when you've been at committee that the RTI information was really going to be the big answer and was really going to give you a lot more clarity. So is that kind of disappointed a bit?
I think it's surprising just how different it was this time around. The first thing is it's still a really helpful indicator, because it means that we were uplifting our forecast all the way through. And if we can essentially say that we know from administrative data what has been collected by PUIE through the year, and we can see that for Scotland, that's still really useful. The bit that we don't know at the end is how that's then adjusted once people then report and all the changes happen to people's tax code and various adjustments, etc. That's the bit where, and it might just be because it's the end of COVID and it's just been a really volatile tax year and there's been lots of things going on, that gap, that error between the PYE outturn data and the PYE RTI data is bigger than I think we would be hoping it would have been.
I think it's worth adding. It is the other surprise is that Scotland was stronger than the rest of the UK, and I think we had sort of had the working assumption that self-assessment would be roughly the same across the UK, and that divergence between the two parts is also a bit of a surprise in here.
And the self-assessment money in Scotland is more volatile than the UK, or we're not sure about that?
I think the potential for it to be more volatile is higher in Scotland because of the numbers, particularly because if you're talking about the people at the really high end, because you've got a small number, so percentage variations are likely to be higher, as we see on top rate taxpayers, just because there's a smaller number and it's a smaller sample size, so it's likely to be higher in terms of variability.
We've got too little data to really say anything very much more than that. I think it's...
Thanks, Claire. There's an interesting chart on page 50, which shows the self-assessment revenue growth between Scotland and the UK. And you see a number for Scotland is just more volatile than the UK.
Yes.
I'll keep that warning that, you know, with that many observations, I would be nervous of making a very strong statement about volatility.
But that doesn't necessarily reflect that the economy or anything like that is much more to do with just individuals.
Yeah, and exactly. As I said, you've got 18,000 taxpayers in Scotland paying the top rate on the latest information, and that amounts to about 2.5 billion. So you have a few hundred of these moving around, and that number becomes that much bigger. And it's just a scale effect. And it comes back to it's a scale effect, but it's also because, under the nature of the devolution settlement, we have this one tax, which is the most important. In the UK, this would be matched by errors on VAT or errors on corporation tax, offsetting it all, but it becomes so much more important in our context.
Okay, and I think the final thing I wanted to touch on was just the total number of taxpayers had increased, if I understood that correctly. I think it was 5.1%. And then perhaps linked to that, the immigration was higher than expected, and I think that was from the rest of the world rather than the EU. Can you say anything on that?
Yeah, so we revised up our migration forecasts last time, in part through the international part element of it. The growth in taxpayers again can be things like people moving into the system, so it might not actually be, it doesn't have to be more people in Scotland, but clearly that, you know, a higher number of people in Scotland, that leads to a growth in taxpayers, but can also mean people moving into tax bands, so things like freezing the personal allowance and not increasing the personal allowance by inflation means that as people's earnings go up, more people will move into the tax system. And again, we talk about, there's an interesting table on page 19 of the report where we talk about the growth in number of taxpayers. And interestingly, what you see is actually people moving into higher rates of tax bands, which is quite interesting, and that is potentially affects the fiscal drag. It's potentially effects of where earnings growth is concentrated in the labour market. And I think unpicking that and understanding that is going to be really important for our updated forecasts. Is that something of a trend that we're seeing in higher earners, earnings growth contributing to higher income taxes?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose I would have expected that that's right, people moving up as the limits were maybe frozen. I was a bit more surprised that the actual total number had increased, fair enough. Right, thanks, Camino.
Okay, thank you. And just a wee quick off the top of my head calculation tells me that if there's 18,000 of these higher taxpayers, top rate taxpayers are paying an average of just under 140,000 a year each. So it is indeed a very interesting section of the taxpaying public. Michael?
Yeah, thanks, Camino. I'm going to stay with that area for a couple of minutes, if that's okay. Obviously, an area very significant political debate, and you understand why we're particularly interested in it. Given the level of volatility, which from the sounds of things is partly tied to how few of these people there are and small variations, how much confidence should we as a parliament and this committee be setting by your own work and predictions? I mean, does that come with a strong health warning when government makes predictions around the contribution to the deficit of the higher rate of tax?
I think so, and I think as we get more data points, we can offer much more clarity around the potential for variability and change and uncertainty that exists here. Now, you know, the nature of what we do, we have to give you a central forecast. I think we can do more to say, and around that central forecast, this is the potential variability that you could see in here. So we've got a really good data point where, you know, the RTI data and all the information we had suggested a reconciliation about 700 million. It's turned out about 400 million. So if I come next year and say the reconciliation is 200 million positive, then I'll be able to say to you, but remember when we were here last year, this was the potential variability that we saw in all of that. So, and that really matters for top rate taxpayers as well. And again, it's one data point, and what we don't know whether this is a really good year for Scotland. Is this a bounce back? Is this something due to COVID, or is this part of a trend that we're seeing over time? And again, being clear with you about the potential changes that could happen with that and how you then interpret that will be really important.
The Fraser-Rylander Institute has told the committee that it could be up to a decade in terms of to provide sound modelling around behaviour effects. I mean, does that sound like a realistic prospect? You talk about, you know, more data points is a good thing, but...
Yeah, exactly. I think we'll be able to start seeing more over the next few years. So HMRC have been working on pulling together data sets that can then be used, not just by us, but by academics to actually look at these effects and see whether changes are going there. And what you need, of course, is that combination of data points to make sure you're not dealing with individual years, but also change. So you actually want governments to change policy, because then you can see behaviours moving after that. And that, so in many ways, actual governments announcing things and doing things from a statistical point of view is actually really quite good. And then you can see whether that happens over time.
Professor Braden, would you want to come in there?
No, sorry, I was just slightly musing about the fact that, you know, we'd like you to roll a dice and set some policies so that so we can see what happens, which I think we're a little bit wrong. But I also say, I think, and a point I think I make every time is that, although we have errors around our forecasts, the errors are of both sides. So I think if we say, like, there's a really big number in our forecast, just saying that, they make mistakes, let's ignore it, I think that's the wrong way to interpret it. You have to say, they focus a big number, which could be even bigger in practice or could be smaller than we don't know. And so we just have to try and work with that number, not say that number is sort of not worth anything because it has an error around it.
It just strikes me that we could be finding ourselves 5 years down the line and there's such significant externalities in terms of the behaviour of such a small group of people that actually the data points that we're talking about to date may be moot.
Yeah.
Yeah, it could be. And there are various techniques you can do to reflect on that. So you can try and match different taxpayers across the UK and control for different effects and see things. There's been stuff done on LBTT, for example, looking at changes in tax policy and looking at people shifting forward. So you can see behavioural effects through there. But clearly, clearly the UK has got decades of income tax data. So there's lots of detailed studies about how people are shifting and changing behaviours up or down, and we just need that data sets. Okay.
On your points around adult disability payments, you talked about the increasing level of applications. Is that matched by a increasing level of awards? Is there a differential between awards between the UK and the and Scotland?
We're seeing this across the UK, an inflow of applications and an inflow of people, you know, claiming in the UK context personal independent payments, so PIP payments, and then adult disability payments in Scotland. So we're seeing increasing applications. And but I would caution that that's not yet, we're not yet got definitive evidence that there's a disconnect between Scotland and the UK. We think that will happen because of the nature of the policies, but at this stage, all we're seeing is an inflow, and we need to wait. We need more data points to see.
So
what's
more
happening.
Applications, but are there a higher proportion of awards? So are more being approved?
So we don't have that information yet. So I think Social Security Scotland have said that there's processing delays with the applications, so we don't yet have information of whether the larger number of applications that we expected to see on adult disability payment and have seen are translating into a different success rate in terms of whether people receive the award and what the payment amount is. And what Graham's saying is a lot of the spending on adult we're classifying as adult disability payment is still on the personal independence payment because people haven't moved over to the Scottish system yet. And across the UK, we've seen that increase. So most of the forecast error where we're seeing higher disability spending at the moment is that UK-wide trend, but it's not yet, we're not seeing evidence that there's no additional cost in Scotland. We just haven't, it's as we'd expect, and it just takes a bit longer for us to get the actual data.
I think it would just be useful as you do more of that analysis if perhaps we could apply a time series to it as well. So if there is, for instance, around the awards, if there's a spike in awards versus applications against a particular time frame, some anecdotal feedback I've been having is that part of the issue about delays in awards may be driving increase in awards. So it would be useful, I think, for the committee and otherwise to try and understand that effect, given how significant this kind of area is in terms of spend.
Yeah. So in our forecasts, what we do is we'll be clear about what we're forecasting in terms of spend, what average payment, applications, caseload, etc., and what we can do is then have a discussion about what we're seeing from that. One of the things you'll remember last year when we came to committee, we spoke about data needs, etc., and one of the things that we were really keen on is having much greater dialogue with Social Security Scotland about exactly these qualitative indicators, so to get a sense from them about how is caseload going, what is happening, what are their trends, what are their expectations, that we can then use judgments about that, and more than happy to set that out in our forecast in December.
And they're very open to those conversations, are they?
Yes, it's been really helpful.
And my last point, Kavina, if I can, on modelling around productivity and childcare. So we have invested as a country a significant amount in recent years in the uplift in 1140 hours. What could you tell us about the relationship between productivity and the economy and that investment that we've made as taxpayers?
Yeah. So there are good theoretical arguments to suggest that investing in childcare leads to improvements in productivity. So in terms of access to the labour market, in terms of better skilling in terms of jobs, etc. I've not seen any evaluation done about whether it's had the intended effects in a significant way, what's been the implications in a dead weight. So that's not anything that I've seen that has then been able to inform our forecasts about saying if you do this policy, this is the impact that you see in terms of productivity. So I've not seen anything specific in a Scottish context. That
it means a very significant area of public investment. Yep. Who would you expect to be doing that analysis? Because surely if that's one of the intended outcomes from the government's investment, taxpayers' investment in that area, you should be seeing those numbers.
Yeah, well, it comes back to an evaluation of policy. It comes back to when you're doing significant investments, you would expect to see the evaluation of policy. And if we can see evaluations by government or commissioning academics doing it, then we can then use that to inform our assessments of what we think might happen to productivity or what might happen to changes in policy over time. But I've not seen anything that we can then use or we have used in our forecasts in the past.
The broad indicator is that we have very little productivity growth in the economy in recent years. So is that correct?
Yes. Yeah. And that's part of a much bigger conversation about what's been happening to productivity in the UK context and issues around measurement, management, changes in sectors, etc. But the key way that you would expect changes in childcare to come through is, one is in terms of labour market participation, but crucially, secondly, through what's happening to productivity. So in theory, it is an area where you could expect to see positive economic improvements from, but as I said, we've not seen anything that is an explicit evaluation that we can then say you've invested X and therefore outcome Y has happened.
Yeah,
I think there's about 12,000 more people employed in the sector, but as you say, the productivity outcome is not something we looked at when we were doing kind of post-legislative scrutiny on this very bill just a year or so ago. Okay, Jamie, to be followed by Gordon.
Thanks very much. Good morning. Just a couple of the points have already been made. I just wanted to kind of follow slightly up on it. In fact, on that point in productivity, if there is high UK productivity but low Scottish productivity, what's the impact of that going forward?
In terms of our fiscal sustainability? Yep. Okay, yep. This is what I have to think off the top of my head. So in that instance, what you would get would be is faster growth in the block grant. So spending could go up in the UK level, and that would feed through to a positive position in terms of the Scottish component of spending. But you would get essentially a faster growing block grant adjustment relative to tax revenues, and that would lead to a squeeze in there. What the net effect of that would be, whether that would still be a positive?
I think it would still be positive. Yeah. Yeah. So I think faster growth in the UK is positive for Scottish finances. Yeah. So yeah. Faster productivity growth in the UK.
I was just also interested in what we were talking about there. Michael Marr was asking about the highest top earning tax, and we've got 18,000. You said that we don't have the data yet from a Scottish context, but we obviously have the UK historical data. Just wondering what estimates you can make on, or what analysis can be done on the tax mobility of those individuals, admittedly within a kind of international context, but that would be probably even more beneficial in terms of, within a UK context.
In our forecast, we do things called tax elasticities, which is how potentially people respond to changes in tax. And we look at things called average effective tax rates and marginal effective tax rates. And the marginal rate is really looking at how people change their behaviour as you suggest at the margin. So if you choose to work more hours or change to shift into different types of income. The average one is about where people make much bigger strategic decisions about whether to work or not work, or whether to relocate and move. So we build in assumptions based on international evidence and based upon UK evidence about what these effects would be. And that then means every time we make a forecast, we have a gross estimate, and then we have a net estimate, which is the effective one that accounts for these factors in there. We don't yet, and this comes back to the discussion we've just been having, we don't have a specific Scottish elasticity that captures people's behaviours yet, because we just don't have that data, and we don't have the time series to see whether or not that would be there. So we use other people's evidence about what's happened elsewhere to help inform what we have in a Scottish context.
But looking at that kind of data from, say, either UK data or perhaps other countries, depending how you do it, there must be almost an additional flexibility within a UK market. So is that what you would expect to see?
I think when we looked at the international evidence, we very much focused on countries with a similar situation. So like where Spain, there are different income taxes across different regions. There was a period in the United States where there was a thing called a millionaire's tax, where very high income people in some states paid a higher tax and other states didn't. And those very specific examples are the ones we've drawn on because, as you say, the tax situation is different when there's internal migration rather than external migration. And that's what's informed the numbers that we currently use. But as Graham says, obviously what we'd ideally like to do is do something specifically on Scotland and to find out the answer for Scotland. And it, as I've said several times, I'm afraid it's too early to say at the moment for that. But it's certainly very much on our agenda to do a Scottish-specific study of these effects. But certainly international evidence is relatively similar across all those countries, which is there is an effect, but it isn't a very powerful effect.
Okay, it's because there could be various reasons why people choose to locate.
Yeah, I think people are surprisingly, because the US one is possibly the most surprising one, people are surprisingly stuck to whatever state they were brought up or they've chosen to live in, even if it, because obviously the US is a very mobile economy, and yet even there you find that the tax difference didn't generate a very big amount of movement.
That's interesting. I just wondered a couple of other things very briefly. One, we've talked about fiscal sustainability looking for the next 50 years. I was wondering how that can be broken down to a regional basis. Obviously, I represent the Highlands and Islands. Healthcare and other services in the Highlands and Islands are very difficult to deliver, more expensive to deliver. So one would expect the fiscal sustainability of those services to be under even more pressure. I'm wondering how much the data can forecast, can reflect that.
It's a really good question, and we did a bit in the fiscal sustainability report where we look at population projections across the regions of Scotland. I think we looked at local authorities, and you see huge variations between particularly the rural areas, population declines, places like Inverclyde, old industrial parts, and then the east of the country, you know, increasing expenditure. Now, we don't go into the detail about what that means at a local level for fiscal sustainability because we look at the national level. But the point you're raising is that there's a really interesting subtlety in all of this about how do you manage this at a more local basis. So on the one hand, you look at places like Edinburgh and Midlothian and East Lothian where rapid growth, you know, there's pressures there on spending as the growth really increases in people there. But then in rural areas, you've got the potential increases in cost of delivering the same quality of service to fewer people. And that becomes potentially really expensive as well. So there are real interesting subtleties, I think, about going a level below about what the fiscal sustainability questions could be at a regional level, and then therefore at a national level, because it actually could be potentially even more costly because of the pressures on delivering the same level of service in areas where populations are growing, but equally in areas where population is declining.
And while you don't look at the data's there to be able to make those projections, because obviously if you live in a rural area or an island community like I do, there's already concern about how services are delivered, how expensive they can be. I won't go on to ferries or other things, but there are lots of issues there in terms of spend that are going to need to be made over the future. The concern is that pressure is only going to grow. So, you know, how does government prioritise or at least ensure that that spending is
there? Yeah, and I'd hope that the principles that we've taken in the fiscal sustainability report would give people who are interested in that local context similar ideas to do what we've done, where you're looking at costs of delivering and being really transparent about that, being really transparent about population and then pushing them forward. And these are not forecasts. I'm not saying this is exactly what's going to happen. It's just raising that if you do arithmetic about what happens with cost of delivery and population demographics, these are the pressures that you will face.
And just last question, very, very quickly. It was on, in terms of house prices. Obviously, there was an underestimate on the revenue from that, from land and buildings transaction tax, given there seems to be certainly some areas of slowdown and, houses taking longer. Would you anticipate there might be an overestimate for next year?
We lowered our forecast. So we thought that LBTT would be under more pressure next year because of falling prices and fewer transactions because of rising interest rates and the economy, etc. So this is about how our forecast was doing. We have been more cautious when we made our forecast in December last year, we've been more cautious about the growth for this year because we think that the slowing nature of the economy will have an impact on that. We won't know until next year before we see whether that's going to have an impact. And again, we can make judgment and you can make intuitive things that you think interest rates have gone up, the economy is slower, house prices will potentially fall and revenues might be under pressure. However, if you have a small number of high-value transactions in some key areas, or house prices are resilient to changes in interest rates, then it could surprise on the upside. And that's just the nature of forecasting.
Sure. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Gordon?
Thanks very much, Convener. It's been an interesting discussion, and I've got three very quick questions just to round things off a wee bit. So you've quite rightly said that forecasts play a central role in setting the budget, but you've highlighted forecasting errors in income tax of 12%, land and buildings transaction tax of 13%. What impact did that have overall on the Scottish Government's budget that they had available to them?
In broad terms, one thing just to be aware of is that, remember, you've got to also think about how the BGAs are changing as well. So the fact, and this is why the income tax forecast of 12%, is couched by the fact that the government have also got the BGA's change. So what really matters there is the reconciliation, and the reconciliation ultimately of being £390 million. That essentially is essentially the consequence of these forecast errors on income tax. So that gives you the scale of the size of it, which again comes back to the discussions we've had before about the fiscal framework and the ability to manage that, you know, manage that risk in future years.
You estimated it was what, £745 million would be the reconciliation.
Yeah, so this is where it gets quite complex, because if you remember back when we did this in January 2021, we were forecasting we were forecasting higher revenues than the rest of the UK, but we were cautioning to say, hold on a minute, we think this is a timing issue. The UK BGE is going to be revised up. What we were then doing is updating that over time, and we knew there was going to be a big reconciliation. We didn't know how big it was. I can't remember what we were saying at the start, but I think we were talking about 300 million, 400 million. And then as we were getting this RTI data and we're saying, look, it actually looks potentially it could be even more significant. And that's when we pushed it up to 700 million. It's come in at 400 million. And that ultimately is the forecast error between ourselves and the BGA.
The difference between the higher and lower forecast element could have been resource that would have been available to the Scottish Government.
So the 400 million essentially is the 390 million, so the reconciliation there is essentially money that the government have had and have spent, but now essentially what they're having to do is manage that back.
The timing and differences.
Exactly, yeah, and that's the fiscal framework. So it's not money that they've lost, it's money that they just have to manage how they then deal with that forecast.
They have to manage a lower amount than previously estimated.
Yeah, so the 390 million is going to, they've now got, that's going to come out of the budget next year, and that ultimately is what they've got to potentially remove.
So in terms of your modelling going forward, has the forecast errors that you had led to any changes in that model so that you can reduce the level of forecast errors?
Yeah, so again, there's a couple of things. I wouldn't say that we're going to change much on our forecast. Mm-hmm. So the budget that we push out, that's the one that really matters. That's the 390 million, and that's our judgments in the economy, that's our judgments in employment, earnings, etc. And they were pretty solid and pretty accurate. The bit that we've been discussing about, I think, today is the how we update that information as we go to give the committee and government a potential real-time indication about how accurate these forecasts are going to be. And that's the discussion we've had about this RTI data, which is essentially tracking administratively PAYE data for Scotland. So it should be really good. Okay. What we see this year is actually, instead of predicting 14% growth, it was only predicting 12% growth. And that's where the error has been.
And my final point, and I accept you may not have seen these figures, but we were talking about the volatility of this self-assessment taxpayers. What impact do you think the acceleration in the move to the cashless society has had? There was a report last year which said that 23 million people in the UK no longer used cash, and that within a decade that number would be closer to 6%.
It's an interesting question. It's probably not one that I've thought too much about, in the sense that a self-assessment and PYE is much more about the earnings that you take, your track record in terms of the income that you have received. So the question is, I guess, is there a suggestion that if you're moving to less of a cashless society, there's more of a tracking, which means that there's potentially more reporting going into it. I mean, that's interesting, whether that means that there'll be more official stuff coming through PYE and self-assessment, because there'll be less in some particular activities. And that's an interesting...
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you very much, Gordon, and that's concluded questions from the committee. I've just got one further question, which is just really about David Bell's paper. It was because John touched on it, I thought I should maybe do so likewise, because one of the things that we discussed in our exchange was the issue of potential spending changes and tax changes that would be necessary, not the specifics, but the fact that they might be necessary. And what Professor Bell talks about is loss aversion. That's something I've raised before in this committee. And that's the issue whereby people, if you give them additional funding for whatever, they kind of shrug their shoulders and say kind of thanks, but if you actually take something away, they're extremely hostile to that, and it causes much more of a political backlash than the gain that you would get from actually doing something of the same financial sum. So what kind of implications do you think this actually has in terms of going forward, in terms of the long-term fiscal sustainability, the ability of governments to actually take decisions that may require to be taken in terms of their ability to take them?
I say one thing, going back to the productivity paper, I mean, we haven't done this in the paper, but clearly at a time when incomes are rising, changing tax policy is actually is easier, because there was just so, it tend to be fewer total losers. There are net losers, but there is a case that you can make changes more with less resistance. In a period like the one we've basically been going through, where incomes have risen very little, then tax policy becomes very sensitive, because you are imposing genuine losses on people rather than just taking away some of their gains.
Your question gets to the heart of the question we've been debating in Scotland 10 years since Christie, which is, we know we need to move into prevention. We know that we need to shift expenditure into areas which will reduce demand and improve outcomes over the long run and improve people's well-being. But how do you do that when budgets are under pressure? Because that means that you're going to have to take money from one area to another, and that's the bit that's just really difficult for any government to do. But I guess our fiscal sustainability stuff hopefully is trying to say, like, we need to do this, because if you don't do this, then it becomes unsustainable, and you cannot afford to keep spending in these kind of key areas without discussions about the economy, about taxation, and about what areas of services you prioritise.
Yeah, I wanted to end on this because fiscal sustainability is going to be the key issue in terms of our budget scrutiny this year. Anyway, thank you very much for your evidence today, Professor Roy and Professor Breeden, and also to Claire Murdoch. It was very much appreciated, as always. It's been a reasonably long session this morning so far, so we'll call a break until 11 o'clock, give our witnesses also a chance to leave and members to have an actual break. Thank you. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence on the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Green Freeports Relief Scotland Order 2023 SSI 2023 draft. A welcome to the meeting, David Mellish, Director of the Scottish Property Federation, Derek Thompson, Scottish Secretary at Unite the Union, and Liz Cairns, Researcher at Unite the Union. So welcome you to the meeting, and I intend to allow up to an hour for this session. If witnesses want to be brought into the discussion at any point, please indicate to clerks. I can then call you. In terms of Unite, I'll direct my questions to Derek, but if he prefers Liz to answer the questions, then I'm quite happy with that. So we'll just suck it and see, so to speak. Okay, so we have your submissions, and I want to thank you for your submissions. So we'll just go straight into questions. I think the first one really is to... As to yourself, David Bass, which is in terms of the responses to the questions that we asked, you talked about the five-year time span being simply too short for the nature of long-term investment for the two green ports in Cromarty and Leith. And you also said that you note that green free ports will not be fully operational at least 2024 or even 2025, and therefore suggest a qualifying period should be extended to at least 7 years. Can you tell us what the benefits would be of that, both to your own industry and indeed the wider Scottish economy? And also, how much investment and employment realistically do you expect to come into these two green ports?
Thank you, Convener. Thank you very much for the opportunity to give evidence as well to the committee. So we think these are a very positive initiative, the green free ports. In terms of the time span, going directly to the question you asked, the nature of our business tends to be very long-term investment. It can be several years, to be frank, before some investors are even in a situation where they can do the statutory pre-application planning and so forth for major developments, and then you, albeit that there is intended to be a smoother planning process as part and parcel of the free ports, it nonetheless takes some time to get the capital expenditure together, to get the teams together, to get the potential attracted businesses into the location as well. So our fear has been that while we think that they're really positive as schemes, that 5 years may simply be there and gone before the relief could kick in. And our fear on that, the so what, I suppose, aspect of that is whether that might put off investors looking at potentially lengthy process from coming at all. We just think that some flexibility on timescales would give them the best chance of the maximum success to bring the jobs, the added value to the economy, and the spur to sustainable growth that's envisaged in the plans. In terms of what's realistic, then yes, we're well aware that I think Forth have suggested something like $6 billion supercharging the economy and more in added value. And I think it's 50,000 jobs, I think the brochure said. These developments do take time. So I think that is... it's feasible, absolutely. It's been well worked through business plans over the period of time. But I do think that a bit more time to pull together all of that investment would actually help both Freeports to be the successes that they could be.
Okay, now, Derek, in your own submission, you talk about some 75,000 jobs. I mean, these numbers seem quite fantastical to me, I have to be honest. But what's your concerns regarding displacement? Because previously, when previous governments have introduced enterprise zones, there have been concerns that it's simply moved one job from one part of the country to another. And obviously, that's particularly acute in the areas that border such zones, including, in this case, green free ports.
Yes, thanks very much, and thanks for the opportunity to contribute. Yeah, so our estimates are 50 at Leith and 25 at Cromarty Firth. That's where we get those estimate figures from. In terms of displacement, so the idea of creating those 75,000 jobs is welcome. It's obviously a great step forward in terms of what it can bring into the economy. But our fear is that business will just run to those cheaper rates and those cheaper areas and start moving people in and moving the work in. If you start taking in some of the areas that are surrounding those two key areas, a lot of deprivation, a lot of poverty, a lot of people relying on jobs within there. If we start moving cheaper jobs and cheaper labour in there, our fear is that people will be displaced, there'll be poorer jobs and poorer communities and poorer areas, and big business will, in our view, rush to try and claim this tax relief at the expense of some of the workers. And some of the areas, you know, although this is not really, you know, the committee for it, but, you know, we are looking at a serious skills and job shortage when Just Transition comes in, because we're not at a position yet under Just Transition to actually determine what a green job is. We start moving jobs out of different areas into these free ports, or green ports, as we like to call them in Scotland, then our fear is that displacement will take place and it will lead to further poverty if we do not get proper jobs reinvested in different parts of the community. So, although we welcome the idea of the free ports or green ports here, we've got real concerns about how that displaces current jobs, displaces people, and actually, in our fear, will leave communities devastated if we don't get this absolutely right in terms of how the other communities are supported through that period.
Well, you've said that in your statement we can't accept an economic situation which allows for private sector employers in freeport areas to increase profits as a result of government subsidies while vital local public services that our communities and those in greatest need depend on are allowed to wither on the vine. But where's the evidence that's going to happen? Because the whole point about this is to actually create economic growth which will increase tax revenues, which will allow further revenues overall for the government to invest in services.
Well, it will create more revenue if the jobs are properly paid and there's proper terms and conditions, and that's why one of our reasons for wanting to be here is to discuss the issue of collective bargaining. Now, our fear is that companies will rush in, they'll be given the tax relief that's here in the papers, but also through that they'll drive down wages, because that's what big business does on numerous occasions. So if we do not get that balance right between having proper wages in those areas, then the tax relief is going to count for nothing, because you're having no tax relief coming in be a big business, and you have little more coming in through jobs created, because you won't have a proper pay system that generates tax and income. So to us, you know, putting the cart before the horse here a little bit in terms of saying they're going to create all these wonderful jobs, we don't have an infrastructure yet for it in place. We're talking about the 5 to 7 years investment programme you're talking about. In our view, the people that are going to come into this are going to be big business who are going to exploit the workers and exploit the system that you're putting in place. So we'd urge a bit of caution on that. And I think the evidence is that if you put more jobs, displace people out of current jobs and move those jobs into these areas, poverty will start increasing in the areas that the jobs are moving from, because business will move to the cheapest area it can get. That's the reality of the situation.
Well, business might move, but I mean, you know, we've got less than 4% unemployment in Scotland, so why would workers move to an area if their wages were going to be lower, etc.? Would they not just actually get a job somewhere else? I mean, you know, surely 75,000 people are not going to move to get lower wages, etc., into these zones. I mean, that's not really credible, is it, that people are going to move to accept lower wages in an economy where there's actually chronic labour and skill shortages already?
Are you saying that people won't move into these jobs?
Well, from existing jobs, because actually that you're talking about displacement. If people are going to be displaced, they're not going to be displaced on the basis of lower wages and poorer working conditions, are they, surely?
Well, I'm pretty sure a big business, if they can get an idea of moving their business to one of these green ports, they will move it. That's the reality of the situation.
I think in somewhere like Cromarty in particular, where you've got, you know, a vast community spread over a wide range of a wide area, you've got the situation where these jobs are going to be offered, and the national insurance relief starts at or goes up to 25,000. Now, those sorts of jobs in an area like Cromarty would be very attractive jobs to go into, but within that community. We did a freedom of information to ask about the level of loss to the public purse of the introduction of the lower or no tax, no national insurance for the 25k jobs, and the HMRC, who we did the freedom of information to, advised us that for every job, there's a £2,400 loss up to the 25k. Now, if we're talking about 75,000 jobs potentially, 25,000 in Cromarty and 50,000 into Forth, that's £180 million just for the tax year 2020, most recent tax year.
But that assumes 100% displacement. I mean, I thought the whole point of these green ports is to create new
I think additional jobs. Displacement happens, can happen by an employer without an individual having any responsibility over it. If an employer decides that they want to move for that reason, they might close that factory down and just make people redundant, move into the new green port and start new jobs, because it has to be new jobs that benefit from this tax relief. So it might make people redundant in communities and the employer goes, but the people might stay. Some might go, some might be willing to go, but there might be others that won't be willing to go or unable to go.
Yeah. I mean, I'll put a lot of these questions to the minister when he actually gives evidence, of course, but you know, to see what he has to say about it. But David, what kind of jobs do you envisage going to these three ports and what kind of businesses?
Well, I think the intention is very much that it will be the new style economy, so green manufacturing and support for maintenance in those terms. So, and I think it's generally accepted that's an area where we hope to do better as a country in Scotland as a whole. There's been one or two false starts and that's it. So I think I'd like to think that there would be less displacement than, you know, than feared by colleagues. But I'm also aware that I think there have been commitments by the people behind the free ports to real living wage, for example. So, you know, hopefully not the... again, hopefully would alleviate some of the concerns expressed. And I think, although it's not my area of expertise, I think on NICS, I think Cromarty have proposed reinvesting the equivalent of NICS in reskilling in order to try and avoid an unbalance with businesses around the area. So I think, I mean, my feeling is that these concerns have been very aware by the proponents of the two successful bids, to be fair, by the government and by the associated local authorities that have been behind the sort of bid brochures and so on, and how the scheme's been developed. I think the emphasis is on encouraging things that might not otherwise have happened. In that sense, it would, on balance, be new jobs. Would it be 100% new jobs? Possibly not. But I don't think it would be 100% displacement. I do think the overwhelming balance would be to the benefit of more jobs and more investment in these new technologies and manufacturing opportunities, actually.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't think for a minute it'll be 100% displacement, but I don't think it'll be zero displacement either. I mean, it's bound to be somewhere between the two, and I think that's a concern.
Yeah.
Does anyone have any evidence on what the likely level of... I mean, obviously we're asking this for the Scottish Government specifically, but I wonder if any of our guests have any evidence on what kind of level of displacement they feel is likely to happen. Or could happen, you know, best and worst scenarios.
I think you raised a couple of points there. I think are important when you talk about the jobs that will go into these green areas. You talk about green jobs or green manufacturing, and so this brings me back to this displacement by companies that Liz has alluded to, where the business moves, but maybe not the people. So, you know, you're talking about green manufacturing, green jobs. You know, nobody can tell us what a green job is yet, actually. You know, is a green job going to be somebody on a delivery bike? Is that on an electronic bike? Is that going to be classed as a green job? There is no guaranteeing green jobs when it comes to green manufacturing. So if you take the oil and gas industry, for instance, on that, up Aberdeen and down the upstream, downstream, back down to Grangemouth, it's a whole list of jobs within there that are potentially going to change over under just transition to potentially green jobs, right? But that's not been defined yet. So if you're saying that green jobs could be moved into Leith or could be moved into Cromarty Firth, then it's displacing potential jobs in the oil and gas industry, because if the green manufacturing is going to be done for there. Also, the issue of manufacturing needs to be raised, because the Scottish Government is not investing in manufacturing. We want manufacturing done in this country. If we're going to build new technologies and new green energy and new construction things, then it should be built and manufactured in Scotland. And that's perhaps where those jobs can go into in some of these areas. But there needs to be a wider thought on how the economy is going to look here. You can't just say we'll put green jobs in over here without thinking where the green jobs are going to go, because the investment from oil and gas companies at this point in time is to do their new green energy work onshore in this country,
All right, so there's going to be building work that's going to be done. There's going to be, you take the offshore wind farms, all that kind of manufacturing. Why is that not getting done in Scotland? Why can that not be built and the technologies not be built in some of those areas? So those are questions that we keep asking, because there is no agenda to just transition yet. And this, in our view, Green Ports is part of the just transition agenda, because you're moving jobs into these areas, claiming them, you know, to potentially be green or newer jobs. But they've got to replace existing jobs if they're new jobs, because the technologies aren't there to get the things done. And also, the issue around oil and gas and just transition, I think, is so bigger than what people think it is. It's not just oil and gas. There's going to be massive areas of just transition and across the energy networks, across local authorities, across all rafts of areas where jobs are going to be under threat and new training is needed. So perhaps we need to have another go at thinking about how these areas are going to be utilised by the Scottish Government and utilised by the economy. But the other area that I just while you're talking about that, is the first road into these areas, into these two places, is going to be construction. Because construction is going to be the area that they're going to need to grow the construction, the buildings are going to need to be built, the foundations are going to need to be put in. And what we don't want to see, and this is a real danger with construction, is that if you do not get the procurement processes right and you do not get investment right, then what happens is you have self-employed and bogus self-employed companies and making fortunes out of these areas, and people not paying tax, because that's exactly what happens under bogus self-employed. So the tax gains that you think are going to be getting from this, we just don't see as being reasonable at this point in time. I don't think it's been... And I'm being as critical and fair as I can, I don't think it's been well thought through in terms of how the bigger picture looks in terms of the wider economy for Scotland.
I mean, I think there's anyone who's looked at the last issue of Private Eye will see some of the comments and how well I've done over the last few weeks about some of the alleged shenanigans going on in Teesside, where, of course, there's a freeport being developed there. I mean, I think one of the issues about displacement is if there wasn't one in Leith, perhaps there'd be displacement to actually Teesside, and I think that's an issue which was perhaps one of the reasons why Leith was considered as a location. But back to yourself, David, in terms of one of the things that you've raised concern about is forward funding arrangements. So, if you can elaborate a wee bit on that.
I think it's closely tied to the point made earlier about the long-term nature of investment. I mean, the developers, they tend to be facilitators of capital. They go and attract the investment from around the world, so sometimes beyond Scotland, often beyond Scotland. And they're competing for that capital. So yes, if we didn't have green freeports, then I think we would be disadvantaged compared to the freeports, not just in Teesside, but elsewhere in England. But the developers will often be attracting that forward funding. So in other words, the effectively passporting that investment into the ground, as it were. And nonetheless, in the immediate period, they are taking on the development risk, making sure that the structure goes up as intended, it's got the tenants and so forth that will come in and be the actual businesses that in the long term will provide the employment and the tax revenues in the locations. But typically, and much more nowadays, typically, rather than just getting old-fashioned lending from a bank, it will be with an institutional funder or a range of institutional funders who could be located anywhere, and to get the capital expenditure they need or be able to depend on in the lifetime of the project, they'll be required to turn for forward funding. Our concern in the arrangements we expressed was whether the relief would go to the developer who's initiating all the upfront capital expenditure and works, or whether it was the long-term owner. And I think that question we've put to the government. They've decided not to amend the regulations, as the committee will be aware. So it remains a concern of ours. I understand anecdotally it wasn't picked up in England either when they did the similar regulations, but nonetheless it does remain a concern of ours based on what developers are saying to us in Scotland.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to open up to colleagues round the table. Just one final question, it's to yourself, Derek and Liz. And you've said in the response to question three that Unite would argue that there's a deliberate lack of clarity on whether trade unions will be able to access and organise workers operating within the zones and to bargain with employers over pay terms and conditions. So who do you think is responsible for that lack of clarity?
Can I come in here? One of the things about the differences between the free ports in England and the green port, free port in Scotland was the ability to have effective voice that was specifically mentioned with regards to, you know, and trade union engagement. However, one of the things that was raised within that was signing up to the business pledge. And we know that the business pledge has failed. The business pledge has basically got 0.4% registered businesses signed up to it. The last time I looked, I think it was something like 700 businesses have signed up to the pledge. The voluntary arrangement for people, for businesses being fair to workers, is not something that's going to happen in these sites. It doesn't happen generally, but it's less likely to happen in these sites. When you're relaxing and deregulating and then giving incentives to organisations, the last thing they'll be doing is dishing any of that. The employees are unlikely to benefit from any of that. As I mentioned earlier, this £25,000 cap we also feel will be used as a comparator, perhaps beyond the region. So it's, you know, to suppress wages generally. They may come up with other creative ways of paying beyond 25k, which doesn't go through the normal routes for some workers to attract them. But we think that the 25k will definitely suppress wages, not only within the Green Freeport area, but externally. So that's...
Okay, I think colleagues will press some of these issues obviously further as we progress. I don't want to kind of hog the whole session. First colleague to ask questions will be Ross, to be followed by John.
Thanks, Convener. Just going back to the Convener's original line of question around displacement, that request for evidence. The theory behind free ports has been tested in the UK before. We've had free ports in the 80s. It was one of Thatcher's kind of signature economic policies. And there have been studies on displacement as a result of those free ports. And, you know, the study that I'm looking at here, which I think is regarded as the kind of major one in this area, but I could be wrong, I've certainly seen higher figures. But this study by Larkin and Wilcox, which was 2011, said it was 41% displacement. So 41% of the jobs that were created in the UK's free ports of the 80s were not new jobs. They were jobs displaced from elsewhere. So, David, I'm wondering if, from your perspective, you know, you acknowledged it's not going to be 100% new jobs. There is going to be some level of displacement. Would 41% displacement be allowable? Would that be satisfactory? Or do you think that's too high a rate of displacement if we see that happen again this time around?
So in answer, I mean, we're in a very different economic environment, are we not? I mean, the labour market is a lot tighter than it was in the 80s with very deep industrial recessions and so on. So I wouldn't anticipate a 41% displacement. I mean, displacement could be in many ways. Could people be going to better jobs in a better location? I mean, there are all those other factors that could be argued might be positives. But given that we're really focused on trying to create new jobs here, I think that broadly speaking, be some disappointment with that level.
And one of the growing areas of inequality in Scotland now, economic inequality, is between East and West. Now, given the location of these free ports, there's already been a lot of concern expressed by particularly local authorities in the west of Scotland who are already dealing with significant challenges of deprivation and depopulation. Take Inverclyde or Gowan Butte as examples. Her concern that as a result of the free ports, the economic displacement expected through them will result in further depopulation and lack of investment in the economy of the west of Scotland, which has already seen far lower growth in income, for example, than in the east coast. Would that be of concern at all to the Property Federation if we saw that further displacement from west to east just aggravating those existing inequalities?
Well, we're a Scotland-wide organisation, so you know, we're there to encourage investment across the country. Look, I am aware of this. I'm also aware that, you know, Cromarty and Edinburgh get picked for the green freeports, and then Glasgow and Aberdeen get the innovation zones or around the university. So, you know, this and there was, you know, obviously Dundee weren't happy at all because they're on the East Coast and they didn't get either. So we're aware of those considerations. I'd like to think because we're boosting new jobs that it is looking to boost the economy overall. I think in the West, I mean, the area around Glasgow has a hugely diversified economy, and I think as and is already attracting a lot of investment right now from our industry that I can perceive. So I would, and particularly based on the strength of its universities, there are other forms of investment that will come to the Glasgow area. So something to keep an eye on. Yeah,
surely those other forms of investment are inevitably going to be drawn east and north now. Like we've already seen, I accept what you're saying, there are strengths to Glasgow, greater Glasgow's economy, of course there are. But we can see in both depopulation and in relative growth in incomes and earnings that there is a clear shift from west to east. Do the freeports not just exacerbate that? And that's to the disadvantage of your members in the west.
I mean, you're talking about a long-term trend there, but I think there are other initiatives that will balance out. I mean, Glasgow is still the greatest centre of population in the country as we speak now. We've around 2 million around the area. And as I said, I think with some of the other initiatives that are at play, including boosting to manufacturing, AMIDs and so on, as well as the growth intent that the city's trying to push in terms of the city centre and turnabout, I think... You know, long term, there will be opportunities on both west and east, but they may be different. I mean, this is going to be very business specific, is it not, in terms of where you go into the freeport? So, I think it's difficult to draw sort of broad generalisms. And I think the trend you talked about has been one that's been apparent for factors for some time. I don't necessarily think this will noticeably exacerbate it. Is the only answer I can give at this stage. It's a little bit crystal ball gazing to a degree, but I think the balance of other initiatives and investments in those areas to the west and further up to the north and northeast will help to balance that out.
I get why you're saying that, but given the evidence we've got from the last time the UK tried freeports and the massive level of displacement there and the fact that we've already got this gap between east and west, I think it's reasonable to see this as one of the risks that at the very least needs mitigated. I'm interested in one particular area of your written submission, though, where you talk up the fact that investments in the freeport zones will meet strict environmental and social criteria, and therefore there'll be that wider environmental and social benefit, not just economic benefit. But my understanding is kind of related to what Liz was touching on a moment ago there, that whilst the tax incentives are very clear and laid out through this statutory instrument, a lot of the environmental and social criteria ultimately depend on voluntary agreements. Is there not a significant risk here that organisations will invest, might even fulfil those environmental and social criteria for at least the first few years, but there's no way to guarantee that they will for the long term? There's no clear enforcement mechanism here to make sure that those criteria are actually met in the long term.
And I mean the proposals were accepted on the basis that they would maintain their commitments, is my understanding, and that was a bit behind our written submission. But I mean the governance arrangements in place in both, they're not just private sector, so there's public and private involved in those both. So accountability, I think, has been built in from the outset. And I don't know the details of the 80s arrangements. I'm sorry, I don't know if that was always the case then, but it does feel like a very different circumstance, both economically and governance-wise, I would argue. So I think that would be our reply to that at this stage.
Thanks. Just final question for Derek and Liz, time convener. Going back to the one of the questions the convener asked you, your submission mentions a deliberate lack of clarity around particularly union access to workers in the freeport zones. Now, I think the word deliberate there really charges that. I wonder if you could say a little bit more about why you think that is deliberate rather than just an oversight, something that neither government is prioritising. Do you think that there's a deliberate attempt to leave the Fair Work stuff pretty vague while pressing ahead with the tax breaks? And what makes you think that?
Well, I think history makes us think that when we're talking about these levels of investments, and I think the for us, there needs to be the sustainability built in for the ongoing. You know, new jobs have been built, that there's protection built in for workers. That has to be something that should be outlined from the very start. In any process, in any bidding, and any procurement policy that goes out, there should be something built in that's protection for workers. And we don't see that happening in any way, shape or form. And, you know, I mean, with all due respect to everybody here and yourself, you know, our history tells us when new business like this starts, a new investment like this starts, that generally the worker is the person who's left behind the most. And when you're particularly giving tax relief like this into big zones where people are coming in, you know, our experience tells us that, you know, that the person who's going to pay the most in that is predominantly going to be the worker, because there'll be no health and safety rights. And that's why in some of the things that we're asking for is just to have those things built in, the fair work stuff. I'll give you an example. I mean, one of our deputy regional secretary met with Edinburgh Council to discuss the issue of freeports and got very little from them on anything. No consultation, had to be probing questions. We are having to ask for information that's not forthcoming. And I think that's one of our big issues with this, is that how are we supposed to be, you know, supportive of some an initiative like this, which we are generally in terms of the jobs, but without the workers' protection and workers' rights built in, and health and safety built in, procurement policies built in, that's going to allow us to make sure that it's properly funded, people are getting proper wages, and it's not getting done on the cheap, then we want something more concrete in any bids and proposals going forward for that. So, Liz, do you want to add to any of that?
Yeah, I was just going to add something to say that basically, in the absence of any devolved employment law, the only thing that we can ask, you know, for this committee and to be heard is on procurement. And the sort of money that we're talking about here in procurement is a way for the Scottish Government to definitely lay down the rules. We should have been at the table. We feel we're behind the curve here because we've been put behind the curve. We're not being listened to when we get opportunities. That's why we've come to this. We're no tax experts, you can tell. That conversation earlier on was just over my head in terms of Professor Roy, etc., in terms of like how the fiscal situations. But we were given an opportunity here to put our position with regards to the lack of consultation with trade unions generally, the lack of engagement with this for trade unions. We're not at the table. It's unfortunate the STUC can't be here today, you know, as well. They would be able to reiterate a lot of what we're saying, not just from our union, but from other unions that have got concerns and other affiliates of the STUC. But, yeah, we don't have employment law devolved at this point. Procurement is an opportunity. This is public money that's going into these free ports, green ports. And we should have a bigger say on it. If effective voice is really means something, and if fair work really does mean something to the Scottish Government, they have to bring us on board and they have to listen to what we've got to say. Our members are concerned. We're here to represent them. You know, over 140,000 workers. And, you know, they want their voices heard. They need to know that their concerns about these things, you know, it can be put into a paper, but we need to actually be at the table. We need to be looking at ways that I think evaluation and monitoring is important. We need to be looking at, you know, when are the decisions made? Who made those decisions? Who made the decision not to include trade unions rather than, you know, who made it to include, which we want to happen, so...
Yeah. Given us plenty to ask the Minister when he comes to lay the instrument. Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Ross. John, to be followed by Michael.
Thanks, Convener. I think we've covered quite a lot of ground already. Just on the time frame, Mr Mulhouse, the 5 years, I mean, it does seem to me quite short, and even 7 years seems to me quite short, because, I mean, I've got Clyde Gateway in my constituency, and they're looking at a 10-year timescale, I think, often for getting a development filled up and so on. So, I mean, what are the risks around that? A, that nobody is interested to start with because it's too short a timescale, or is there a danger that people walk away after the 5 years?
Well, I think the upfront danger is the one you've identified, as alluded to earlier, that people look at it and think, well, if we've only got a few years to get everything in place, then It might just simply be too short, and you know, we have members with examples of single buildings that can take 8 or 9 years because of the complications involved in that. So it is short. I mean, I suppose at 7 years, discussed with members, you know, we realise that it couldn't be open-ended because at some stage the government will want, you know, the new economic transactions to start delivering the full revenues that are anticipated in time. But I think it's the fear that it's just too short a timescale for major investment to fully deliver on its potential is our concern there.
Mm. And you think 7 would make a difference?
We do think 7 would make a difference. I would accept longer would probably be more beneficial. So given the sort of, well, given that, as I expected, you know, you can see individual projects taking 8 or 9 years, but I think we were trying to strike a balance at 7 years with what people felt would just add that little bit more time for investors to make progress, but at the same time not have something that the government might see as too open-ended.
Okay, thanks. And yeah, I'll ask you the other one now, come back to the Unite folk, but I mean, I think the Scottish Fiscal Commission has said the impact will be less than £5 million, that is, in lost LBTT. So they're not kind of commenting because that's a relatively small amount by the whole Scottish tax take. But having said that, I mean, that £5 million, that LBTT that's lost is fairly definite, whereas any money coming in is fairly uncertain. Does it not concern you that if we go ahead with this scheme, that public services are going to have to face a cut to match it?
No, and do recognise the Fiscal Commission expertise in this. But I mean, this is about trying to create things, making things happen that are currently not happening. And I mean, I think that's probably where we come from. So I think in the longer term, you know, even when buildings are built, they will change over. There'll be new tenants coming in, and there's tax paid at that point, and so on. And new buildings will be replaced and created on sites once they've got critical mass and success of investment as well, and which might be beyond. Let's just say we get the 7 years that we're asking for. So I think in the long run, no, I think it will be. There will be more LBTT in the long run, because at the moment I think the intention is that, you know, it's getting new investment into places that's not currently happening.
Okay, thanks. Mr. Thompson, just the same two points to yourself, really. I mean, are you concerned about the timescales, or is that not really a factor for yourself?
Yeah, I mean, I think that for us at this stage, probably the longer the better at this stage in terms of where we are in terms of getting things right for us, I think, is where we want to be. But also what I alluded to earlier on, I do think that the Scottish Government is going to need to have a look in more detail at this. I know you're questioning the Minister on it later on, but you know, the implications of what's been discussed here are worrying us even more, I think, when we seem to be talking about new jobs, but nobody can tell us what that new job looks like. And I think they're going to have a serious think about how, and I'm sure we'll be back in front of someday at some point on Just Transition, about how the effects of the movement of work under Just Transition is going to impact on other jobs. But, you know, the new job stuff. So I think for us, we want to, you know, try and get involved in the talks as much more than this, and obviously that longer period is not a concern for us. In terms of the cuts to public services, I think you mentioned in the tax revenue coming down, I think that is going to be a massive concern, as we spoke about displacement. And there is an issue ongoing just now around the amount of tax that is coming into the country due to the stagnation of wages. And I think that has to be recognised in terms of where the money is coming from for investment. So I think in terms of public services, we obviously represent public sector workers as well, and our fear is that more money being taken out of that and pushed into different areas is going to be of a concern for us. But again, I'll take it back to our issue. If we're creating good jobs, and new jobs have to be well-paid jobs. Well-paid jobs bring more taxation in the country. They generate wealth in the local economies that they're built in. But we can't do that to the expense of those areas that are going to have displacement in it. And if as much as Ross says, then I think we're going to have some real concerns going forward in some of those areas.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. To be followed by Liz.
Thanks,
thanks, Convener. And I want to focus on the application process that's gone through around these, and I hear evidence so far, and I think a globally acknowledged problem about special economic zones, special export zones, and the impact on workers' terms and conditions and their rights in those areas. So, Unite, first of all, I mean, how important is it to have a transparent process, both of application and evaluation, for these kind of schemes?
Absolutely critical. I think for us to reassure our members and to reassure ourselves, and also for the Scottish Government to reassure itself that things are happening, we would want to see the clear process of how the tendering started, who's invested in it, what their investment history is like, what is their portfolio like across the rest of the economy, what's the history like in terms of jobs, pay and condition for the workers, do they have any, you know, it's almost like asking for due diligence to be done on investors to make sure that when they come in and they're investing in the Scottish economy, that they're also not just investing in the Scottish economy, they're investing in the Scottish people and investing in the Scottish economy and Scottish workforce, and that was really important for us. In terms of valuation, so, you know, I think there's two things to this. It's evaluation of how the economy is progressing through obviously the LBBT that we're talking about here. But for us, the evaluation is it bringing what it's required to bring into the economy? And I think that's one of the critical questions that we need to ask ourselves here. If we're talking about green ports for an investment in new jobs, particularly green jobs over new and the interest of new technology, you need to have a fair analysis of what those jobs are actually coming in to do. I mean, I made, you know, slight joke earlier on talking about green jobs, and as a green job somebody flying about on an electric scooter delivering food for Deliveroo, but at this point in time we don't know what a green job looks like, and there is no definition out there for us to actually compare what those jobs are going to be. So we don't want new jobs just thrown in to free ports and green zones just for the sake of them being a new job. A new job has to be valuable, has to contribute to the economy, and hopefully if it's proper green new jobs, it's contributing to the just transition and the future of the country when it comes to the economic and environmental needs.
I mean, this is about spending public money, in essence, yeah. And that's what we're involved in here. I mean, do you have confidence in the process of the evaluation of these bids?
Liz?
Not really, no. I don't think enough's been done in terms of being transparent about how the bids have been delivered and who's involved in the bids. I mean, we're doing our own mapping within Unite and trying to find out who's actually in those areas already, existing companies, and perhaps looking who's going to be attracted to this. So I just feel as if there's more work could have been done to make it much more transparent in terms of involving trade unions as well, STUC, in order to alleviate any concerns we would have. Instead, we have to come to you, in front of you, to express our concerns because we don't feel as if we've been involved in the process.
Thank you. And David, I think the essence of your submission is about concerns about whether these plans can be delivered. You know, you've put the time frame. How robust does the evaluation have to be of the kind of applications that are put in order to make sure that we can deliver it? Do you think that we need a robust process that can evaluate the plans that are put forward?
Yes, it needs to be robust. I agree. I do think that part of the reason we raised concerns about the timescale and delivery of when release will kick in was obviously the partnerships that were being put together, whilst they were already strong, part of the bidding process, obviously they have been in process of appointing chief executives, managing directors, and other to actually drive forward those plans. And I think I would trust the people on the ground. I think they're quite strong partnerships between both the local authorities, investors, and businesses involved in those areas. As well as I think the governments have been involved as well, of course. So I think there's quite a strong organisational process which should lead to robust scrutiny and accountability as you go through. But of course, yeah, I mean, you're talking about giving reliefs. We've talked about the issues there about that. So I, you know, would expect that this committee and others will be keeping a close focus on progress.
Do you think it would be acceptable to have a process that was... there was no published criteria, that there was no advertised application route, and that those decisions were taken behind closed doors? Would that be acceptable to your organisation?
In terms of of appointing the successful bids, or as we go forward?
Is it to appoint the successful bids?
So appointing the successful bidders, I suppose the issue was that this was always going to be a by-government decision, wasn't it? UK and Scottish government, and inevitably there were going to be some sensitivities around that. I would say, anecdotally, having talked to some of the UK officials behind the UK government's Freeport's prospectuses back in the day, they were very impressed with the prospectus put together by the Scottish government in the end, and thought it had picked up on some lessons. I think it had picked up on some of the lessons from history that we've talked about already. So I think that process was good.
There was a process and a prospectus. What, in the absence of a process and a prospectus, would it be acceptable to spend public money without any process or prospectus?
No, I think it's giving a fair chance to bidders around the country. So I think that was helpful.
A point well made. And the same question to Unite. Would that be an acceptable situation if we were spending public money without a process, an application process?
No. No. Okay. It has to be fair and transparent.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. List to be followed by Jamie.
Thank you. Mr. Thompson, you've been pretty excoriating in your criticisms of the situation as we face it, and you quote in section 4 of your submission to us that we find this attempt to lure businesses onto these sites on the back of the taxpayer-funded tax breaks abhorrent. That's pretty strong language. Can I just ask you, do you actually believe in the concept of the Green Port, or do you think that the aims and objectives could be achieved by another means?
So we are not opposed to free ports and green ports at this stage, but that's dependent on what comes out of discussions like today, for instance. And we're having these discussions throughout the state, up and down the length and breadth of the UK in different areas. We're obviously dealing with the Scottish side of it. For us, the investment of up to 75,000 jobs in Scotland is obviously welcome, and what that brings to it in terms of new skills and different things is, and obviously the taxation issues, and just for building local economies is going to be critical. But the idea that we just bring them in and give them tax relief that they just get that and don't give anything back is something that we can't agree with. So that's where we come to the issue of proper pay, proper terms and conditions, proper health and safety legislation, a proper procurement process that's open, fair and transparent, and there's not just thrown money. I mean, I'm sure you've been in many committees where you've heard the horror stories of public procurement and funding and where that money goes. You know, you just need to look at some of the stuff that goes on in the health service under the health and social care partnerships, where it can cost £150 to change a light bulb across different areas. So all those issues we don't want to see happening again, and we want to make sure that the trade union and effective voice that Liz referred to is there, and it's there at the beginning. But I do have a fear, personally, that this could end up just being us handing over money and tax relief to big business. And when we start moving them into these areas that become almost deregulated and unregulated in a way, it just opens up for us a potential can of worms. We want those assurances going forward that there is proper health and safety within those areas, that the procurement, that the construction work from the very start is open and honest, and it's built and it's done through proper employment laws and employment legislation. Liz has referred to employment law in Scotland. Hopefully that is something that our union is pushing very hard on in terms of trying to make that happen, and hopefully that would give us more protections. But, yeah, giving money over for nothing back is what we find abhorrent.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Jamie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning. I supported the Cromarty Firth bid. It's not a declaration of interest or anything, but I think it's important to say that. It's important, and Ross talked about the kind of east-west divide, but there's also the north-south divide, and you know, there is undoubtedly an important need to invest in remote and rural areas, particularly across the Highlands and Islands. So I welcome it. I did want to ask, if I could firstly come to Derek and Liz, just in terms of that engagement, you talked about not being engaged through the process and not being engaged. You're not sure what green jobs are. I don't think you're the only ones that find themselves in that position. But I'm just wondering what kind of engagement you've looked to do or you have been doing with the two successful bids, with Cromarty Firth Global, Inverness Port, and also with, obviously, the consortium led by Forth Ports.
We haven't been in. I mean, the one that's been most recently raised is with Edinburgh City Council in terms of, so we're now in the process of trying to engage on those areas, but as we said, what happened at Edinburgh was very, very null and void. And I think there's I think there's a lack of understanding out there in terms of some of, about what has to happen in terms of engagement, do you know what I mean, in terms of negotiation and stuff. And that's why we will keep reiterating that we want to be in at the beginning on these areas so that we can discuss, you know, the workers' issues as it's coming in. And although we might not be at the stage of boots on the ground, but it is important to set a standard and stuff like that. Liz, have you got anything on the...
No, I was just going to say that, you know, we have obviously got a number of members at the Forth Ports, and you know, we've got a very organised workforce there who are pushing this, but they're pushing at you know, a different level from where the decisions are being made about, you know, the bids coming in, etc. So while it might be at a low level, we're having discussions with our members in places like the Forth Ports. It's not at the place where the decisions are being made about who's investing, who's getting whose bids have been accepted. I mean, I think you know, that was what we wanted to be in from the beginning. We want to make our voice heard when we're talking about which companies coming in. We've had situations, particularly in construction, where a number of large, very large organisations have been involved in blacklisting. Are they going to be in there getting public money again when, you know, they've had to pay money back to workers that have actually been blacklisted? So we need to just be more mindful, and we have these answers. We have some of the answers that I think that require to be heard, and yet we're not being asked. And I think that's frustrating for us.
What you're saying about wanting to be there from the beginning of the process and be part of that kind of decision making. But do you not see value... I mean, this is kind of devil's advocate question, really, but do you not see value in that engagement even now with the two winning bids, the two consortiums, and, you know, at least getting that information to them, making sure they're aware of it? Or...
Absolutely, absolutely.
But have you tried to do that? Or
No, I haven't in my capacity, you know, but I think that if their opportunities are there to do that, we would absolutely take up that opportunity. As I say, we are trying to do our own mapping, because we can't get information that we need to know, and that's from our conveners at these sites. And if they can't get them, where can we go to? So, you know, maybe you know, that's something that we can take that up with.
I understand the point you're making on not being listened to, but you know, it doesn't sound at this stage. Even though I understand the arguments you've made before, that you've asked either, and maybe that's an area to start. But that's
it does sound as if, you know, we're coming here to say we're not being listened to, but we've actually made no attempt to try and get heard. But we're getting heard at a level we're not being heard at the level we need to be heard at, and we are contacting people and saying to them, we need to be heard. Can we get a meeting and these sorts of things? But we need to pursue that because, you know, the time is moving on. These bids are being accepted, and funding has been, you know, given to organisations already. Yeah.
Be interesting as well to be updated on how that engagement goes, I think, as well, from our point of view.
We'll pursue that.
Thank you. Thanks very much. And David, if I can just kind of ask you, I mean, one of the issues that we all know, I mean, we, you know, as I say, from my point of view, I was very pleased that the bid in Cromarty Firth and the Cromarty bid was successful, but we also recognise that there's a huge amount of other investment, infrastructure, etc. needed. Transport infrastructure in the Highlands is not particularly good. There'll be a need for housing if these jobs do create, and all people do move to the area. So I was just wondering how important that you feel that could be.
Very important. Short answer. I mean, you know, clearly the Highland Council are very closely involved in the bid, involved in that, and you know, I think have a track record of success in taking forward a lot of initiatives. So, I think that should give us some encouragement in the process. So, but it will be important to build the infrastructure that people will need to make these areas a success. I agree entirely.
And do you think at the moment, I mean, given the bids have only recently been successful, there's obviously lots of work still to do, that governments, and I mean UK government, Scottish government, local government, are working together enough on delivering that peripheral infrastructure as well? I mean, peripheral perhaps, but key as well.
I mean, there's long-term plans and development plans and so forth that Highland are already actively progressing. I do think, and obviously there's a related city-regional deal processes as well, and I I mean, I would say for us, it's very noticeable that, DLUHC, for example, are very much more on the ground and active around the country than perhaps they were a few years ago.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. That's concluded questions from the committee. I just wonder if our witnesses would be happy or if you to ask any further points or make any further points to the committee on something that hasn't been covered. So if you feel that we haven't asked anything that you maybe think you would like to mention, now is your chance.
Try and reiterate just a couple of points that maybe I skipped over, but that is, you know, we'd be hoping for direct employment in those areas, contracts in those areas that have worked. I mean, I think that's really important for us, ensuring that community and local areas are developed alongside it. You've talked about the housing, if people need to move, if jobs are displaced, how does that affect that local community? But one of the key things for us is ensuring that the products or the manufacturing stuff, the concrete, the steel, whatever is done within those free ports, it's all manufactured within Scotland, and that money and those areas are built in Scotland, so that it becomes a proper economy and it's not just, you know, selling things off, or it's like what's happening with the wind turbines where we're importing it all from another country when we could be building them here. I just think there's a real, I just get the feeling on some issues like this that we are, you know, we're running before we're walking, and a lot of stuff. There's a massive change coming under, you know, the just transition, and what the impact that's going to be environmentally, but also in productivity and manufacturing, the things that need to get done. And here's an opportunity, in our view, to get something right at the beginning under Freeports, to get the right legislation in, to make sure the manufacturing is done within this country, to make sure the jobs are kept here, make sure that everything's done reasonably and above board, and giving it a proper boost to the economy, not just, you know, shoehorning things in just because we want to try and create, you know, a bit of a boost in the economy. There's a longer term thought process for Unite when it comes to this, and we hope that you take into account considerations of the wider economy issues that are going to come alongside Freeports, which in our view is the just transition agenda, which will have a massive impact on Freeports, but it's going to have the biggest impact on our economy in any generation in the past. And I hope that our points have been taken on board, and thanks very much for your time.
Liz?
Yeah, I just want to mention skills training and apprenticeships in these communities as well. I think it's important to put in place proper facilities in order to create the next generation. We're talking about not having the jobs, the green jobs. What are the green jobs? Now, there were green jobs in Macrahanish, which have gone, and that was, you know, that was devastating for that community. We can't have jobs that were there that are now lost. We need to make sure there's a future for our young people by making sure that there's you know, skills and training put into the green ports, and also robust apprenticeships where there's real training given on renewables, in order that we do have a future, and it's not going to be something which, you know, if it's not successful in 5 years and the people move, which we've seen in other areas within Scotland, when, you know, organisations come into a place, extract every part of public funding they can get and then leave. We can't have that happening. We need to leave a legacy. We need to make sure that these, if they are anything, they are offering a future, especially, you know, given, you know, an area like the Cromarty Firth and the Highlands and Islands of Scotland, where there's real opportunities there to get jobs for young people that are sustainable, that will stop a movement out of those communities to maybe the central belt. But yeah, it was just ensuring there's a proper skills training and apprenticeship agenda within the green ports.
Okay, thank you. And David?
Just one point on the going back to the displacement question. Whilst we firmly believe, as we said earlier, that this, we want to see additionality, new businesses, and in the long term, new revenues and so on coming from green free ports, not all displacement is necessarily bad. If we've got 50-odd thousand jobs in the northeast that, you know, fossil fuel related and are possibly, you know, facing decline or loss, if Freeports help to save some of them, retain them, then I think that element of retention, even if it is displacement, I'd like to think would be seen positively, because it's retaining those jobs in Scotland rather than losing them elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you very much for those final points, which are much appreciated, and thank you very much for taking the time to give evidence to the committee today. We'll continue taking evidence on the draft order next week, when we will hear from the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth, and then take a decision on whether or not to approve the order. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which we'll discuss in private, is consideration of our work programme. We now move into private session, so I'll call a 5-minute break. Thank you.